Yeah, you ask the question. This is the whole computer science is the, say, what is real world? Why you are doing this class? To get a job. And to get a job, you have to know good programming. The basic fundamental of programming languages are here. Without learning the automata, you do not come to know what is the problem of which cannot be solved, but you have to solve. The lots of programming, so we have to know algorithm, some ad hoc thing. So the automata class should teach you that which is solvable problem, which is not solvable problem. And which is solvable problem, which are the p-type problem. That is the problem which can be done by O1, O(n), O(n) square, like sorting algorithm, n log n march sort. So this, what are the bottleneck complexities, algorithmic complexities, that will be covered in algorithm classes also. But what the algorithm class will not teach, the tougher problems, okay, like 2^n problems, like knapsack problem, like traveling salesman problem, then we have to make an approximate idea, approximation algorithm. So then the uncomputable problem, one example is Turing halting problem, that is unsolvable. So that he has thought in 1936. Okay, so this is unsolvable problem. So this is the things, because if you do not know the basic fundamental of, because all programming languages which are will be coming, all depends on this context-free grammar. 99% of the programming language are depends on context-free grammar. So that is the reason you have a solid grasp on context-free grammar to understand your programming languages. Am I clear or not clear yet?
This subject is, sir, this subject is also related to compiler design.
Definitely. This subject is related with almost every branch of computer science. I am giving you example. One is, this is compiler design, then artificial intelligence, AI, if you have to have a programming, the all fundamental programming things comes from automata class. Okay, that is the distinction between, that is the reason the all the IT companies who are taken the some CAC student and EC student, generally earlier it's the same prank, right now not. So they always prefer CAC students to join first to their campus, Infosys and all, because both EC student and CAC may be in joint, in equivalent rank, they know the programming languages, they know C, DBMS. If you learn the DBMS in third year, they learn in fourth year. They have a more better knowledge in microprocessor and all, but the basic things is, because you come through this automata class, mainly automata class, your and understanding and compiler, you can write, it has been shown that they can write better. So always the CAC students are brought to campus for higher productivity. That is the main distinction point with you computer science student with any EC student from any college, because they are not formally taught the automata class. Okay, good question. Any question, am I clear or it is not clear? In the automata is very fundamental. If you go to the M.Tech class, M.Tech interview, they will ask the question in automata, definitely. Okay. Any other question?
The thing in your lecture that you shared today, mm-hmm. sir, there was one L^m, N^n, something like that. Yes. I did not understand that.
Yes, but please view the yesterday's video. I have mentioned coming to this slide, okay. I think this slide you are mentioning. Am I correct?
Sir.
Yeah. So I have sometimes I give examples with input alphabet sigma A comma B. Here the input alphabet sigma 0, 1. Please, you try to understand in several books. Don't go follow a fixed alphabet. So here, what are the your terminal symbol here? Your terminal symbols is 0 and 1. What are the grammar's variables here? Variables which are not terminal. Your start variable, like FSM, you have a start state. This is the start variable. Nobody mentioned, but it is a convention. S is the start and A is another variable, O one is a terminal, and this is epsilon, that is blank transition. Okay, so this kind of grammar, there may be, I can write it in alternative way, it will raise the grammar a to the power n, b to the power n. Then you say, why sir, why it is a to the power n, b to the power n? Because a to the power n and b to the power n, say why sir it is written here 0 to the power m, 1 to the power n. Yes, they are equivalent because here we have taken the alphabet 0 and 1, and with this production rule you can generate 0 to the power m, 1 to the power n. Same thing with little modification here, you can appreciate, you replace 0 by small a terminal and 1 by small b, you can write the grammar a to the power m, b to the power n. So m and n should not have any relation. Okay, so this is a regular grammar. But whenever there is, like yesterday I told in example a to the power n, b to the power n, here it is 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, basically same grammar, just alphabets are changed. Here you have to measure the n should be of same, then this is the production rule. Say your start variable, it can be 0s1 and s2 epsilon, or you can say with ab it should be s, left hand side s, right hand side small a, s small b, and s goes to epsilon. With that rule you can generate a to the power n, b to the power n, n and n same. So this is, you can see from the rule also that this is not a right linear grammar or left linear grammar. Why? Because your variable come into the middle. Remember I told in regular grammar your variable should come at the end, that is right linear grammar here, or at the beginning. So your grammar is consist of rules. If any of the rules breaks any type, then it go to the higher type. So here no rule there, so that the variable doesn't come in the middle or in the left. So this is a type 3 grammar, regular set, like this. Whenever this rule comes, the variable come at the middle. So this is but still it is a singular person here. So we call context free. You can call it is also context free because it is also subset of context free. This is context free superset. So if somebody call you whether it is a context free grammar, yes it is a context free grammar, but it is also a regular grammar. Okay, you cannot say this is a subset of context free, and but actual context free grammar, pure context free grammar is, which is not regular grammar, variable come at any point. Okay, so this generate the grammar this, and if you this for your reference I tell, the if you have the grammar like a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, or alternately whenever input alphabet 0, 1, 2, if you like 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, 2 to the power n, if you have the production rules like this, see here it is a context sensitive grammar. Why context sensitive? See, this grammar is context free grammar. Okay, these two grammars is context free grammar. But what about this? Here you have a variable and terminal. Here have a variable and terminal. So it is called context sensitive grammar. This is your type 1 grammar. Then another grammar is called type 0 grammar, which is very tough, okay, to understand. So all our computer programming languages are deterministic context free grammar. All C, Java, Python are built on 99% of context free grammar, because the reason is you have to, whenever the sentence ultimately what is the given, whenever you give the written program to a compiler, it will try whether it matches the grammar production rules, formal grammar production rules. So it will take, for linear grammar it is O to the power O n, it is called linear grammar also, sometimes it's called linear grammar. And in context free grammar you can make it also with some little modification O n grammar, but it is O n cube grammar, generally is complexity O n cube, but with some techniques we can make it still O n. But the context type 1 grammar, it cannot be ON grammar. Okay, I'll show you. But till now, any question, please?
This thing that you explained, sir, can you give one example?
This is the example. Like here, what is any number of occurrence of 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n is a regular grammar. Here it is a perfect example of another example is balance parenthesis. You can have rules I can give examples in a note. I'll give you. So all the balance parentheses, all the a to the power n, b to the power n, 0 to the power n, 1, anywhere you see, even you say 0 to the power n, 1 to the power 2n, that is also a context-free grammar. Or you say 0 to the power n, 1 to the power 1 to the power p, p get, should be greater than n. Whenever there is a comparison, this is also a context-free grammar. But whenever you see a 0 to the power n, 1 to the power n, 2 to the power 2n, this kind of grammar, it is a context-sensitive grammar. You can find out the rules this. It is difficult to get back the rules, but these things you have to believe in us or believe in me or books. So this is it, because this work has developed over 30, 40 years of time. Great computer scientists are working on there. So immediately everything should not be obvious, but you have to believe in us that these are the grammar. What is formal grammar? I have told you, this is nothing but a core subset of programming language. All programming languages are built on this grammar, and this grammar mainly the deterministic context-free grammar. This is we more or less covered here that this is a finite state machine and this is a regular grammar, a to the power m, b to the power n, m and n, no relation. We can make a grammar where the left hand side variables should be 1 and right hand side variable at the end or at the beginning, not both. Now comes this is a huge range of grammar, pushdown automata. Why it is called pushdown automata? But you need a stack, and it is very powerful language. And there is a two kinds of context free grammar, and the two kind of machine. Every machine is correspond to grammar. You remember there is a bifurcation here. It is a deterministic pushdown automata, and another is non-deterministic pushdown automata. What is the example of non-deterministic pushdown automata and its grammar? Your palindrome. So palindrome, when from the beginning side and the end side, it's same meaning. So palindrome grammar is very, very tough to realizable in hardware. There are two types of palindrome: odd palindrome and even palindrome. So this is it. So this is these are the toughnesses coming, the complexities. Then it is a more tough when the context sensitive. So hardly our programming languages contains the context sensitive structure. Okay. So everything will be clear, and this is a Turing machine, the toughest. A Turing machine can cater all problems. Say if you have a formula, Turing machine can solve. The Turing machine looks so naive. Is like a read-write head, like an old 60s and 70s tape, but it can solve all the problems. That is the great thing of the computer science, interesting part of the computer science. These things I have covered, here most of our compiler, somebody have asked the question, interesting question, that we in the compiler theory, he will be here, only this here. The deterministic PDA in our formal language and automata theory, we will concentrate here. We grasp here, then we can go here. But in the whole languages are built on deterministic pushdown automata. So here our compiler design theory, next semester I think your compiler class is a good thing. So we'll try to discover. We'll try to see to it. So deterministic pushdown context-free language. Machine matching is a deterministic pushdown automata are matching, 1:1 matching. That's great. Like regular language and regular automata, 1:1. No confusion. Yeah, this is again and again you should remember to hear it. What is grammar? Again and again I told some books it is Michael Sipse's book is NT. It is variable. Variable is a finite set of symbols. Sigma is capital sigma is a set of input alphabets. I have shown input alphabets here 0, 1. Sometimes they give examples A, B. Please do not confuse. It is better to give examples of different books so that you can read any books. P is production rules. It is a set of production rules like the rules I have seen, and from the looking at the rules you can immediately say whether it is a regular grammar or context free grammar or context sensitive grammar. You can from looking at the rule, and you have to have some experience by looking at the sentences pattern, you will be able to see. Like you all know probably A to the power N, B to the power N, or if we say the alphabet say PQ, P to the power 3 q to the power 3. Can you tell me whether it is a regular grammar or not? It is a regular grammar. Like a to the power 3, b to the power 3, it is a regular grammar. You ask why? You just say, sir, a to the power n and b to the power n is not a regular grammar. But here a to the power 3 means ki, I take state transition 3s, I cancel it out, then 3b's. There is a deterministic finite state machine. So a to the power 100, b to the power 100, whether it is a regular grammar or whether it is a context-free grammar, it is a regular grammar. Though a to the power 100 and b to the power 100 same, we do not, whatever I say, every a we go for 100 states and every b we go for 100 states. Say a to the power 1 million, b to the power 1 million, it is a regular grammar. But whenever I say a to the power n, n can be any number, b to the power n, n can be any number, then you need a stack. Okay, so that is the reason that is a called context free grammar. Okay, so this our automata course, and automata course, it will always some back and forth. You can ask question from previous also. It's a good question. Devanko has asked the question, somebody has asked the question, what is the purpose of automata? Any question till now? Yes, okay, thank you. So this is another, this is interesting grammar. This is context-free grammar. I have told again and again, this is a context-free grammar. Here you take the A is the start variable. See, this is a Michael Sipser's books I am taking. Not everywhere AC is the start variable, but it can be only one start variable. Like machine, finite state machine, you know Q0 is the start state. Same as the language, every variable should have a start variable. Okay, so these are, if you see the production rules, by looking at the production rules, here what are the input alphabets? 0 and 1, these are the terminals. And what is the capital A? Capital A is a variable. B is also variable. And what is this hash? This is a terminal. So your input alphabet is 0, 1 and hash. I am coming to this hash. So this is a start variable. And if you just go on repeating the rules, then you can get this kind of strings. You can get this kind of string. Ultimately, 3 zeros, 3 ones, or 4 zeros, #4 ones, 5 zeros, #4 ones. This is the way you are replacing. What is basically beauty of grammar is so that if you have a finite set of rules, but you can create infinite set of languages which can be understood by a machine. That is the great. So your rules basically are generator, and your machine is the acceptor. So you are generating a sentence, and you push the sentence to a machine PDA, and whether it accepts or not, stack empty input, that is accept or not, that is the great. It is same for regular grammar also. With some basic rules, you generate infinite sentence, you put the infinite sentence left to right, dump it, simulate on a finite state machine with maybe millions of states, no issue. If it is even the millions of states, we call it a finite state machine, until and unless it doesn't have a stack. Okay, so then if it is accept at the end, we say accepted or not. Sometimes you might be confused, sir, what is million moon machine? Million moon machine, again a finite state machine, but it gives output for every transition, every input simulation. What is other, before earlier told, I put all the input string to a machine. At the very end, I am getting whether accept or reject. Okay, but milli machine and moon machine, it can do ultimately in it accept or reject, or it might not give accept or reject, then it is also finite state machine. I am telling again and again, the finite state machine, whether it accept or reject doesn't mean it, then it gives intermediate output. So if it is gives intermediate output with the state transition and which state the finite state machine is, then we call the milli machine. Whenever the output is coming, this output and at the end output, that is accept reject, two different output. Okay, our output is coming, intermediate output is coming from the state only, that is called the Moore machine. Moon machine is a stable machine because input transition can occur from various glitches, power circuit and RF interference and all this in a digital circuit. So Moon machine is preferable, like your register, counter, an example of a Moon machine. Okay.
So what is this parse tree?
Yeah, I'm coming to this. Great question. Good question. What is parse tree? Parse tree is nothing but whenever I have a rules. I designed a machine. I give the production rules to the machine, and I push the strings coming out of these production rules to pump it out from left side. Then your machine should go at the end accept state. For it is for final state machine also, it is for push down automata, but also it can derive the it can give a printout, sort of printout, that how the from this string is generated by firing the rules at what time. Are you getting my point? If that output should be like a tree, that output should be like, this is kind of tree, inverted tree, like root at the beginning. So this is not only it should say that whether accept or not, but it should provide a unique, that's parsing tree also should be unique. Say if we palindrome grammar, parsing tree may not be unique. That is not good for programming languages. That is called ambiguous grammar. That is all things are ambiguity of the grammar. We will cover in a few classes. The parse tree, then what is the parse tree? Parse tree is how this string of terminals are generated from your start variable by firing the rules. But if you can produce the same string of terminals with the production rules, different production rules of the same grammar, then we call the grammar is ambiguous. Why the grammar is ambiguous? Because you can generate the same output with different production rules of the same grammar. This grammar is dangerous for programming languages, because if you write a program and at different compiler it interprets differently, your program will run havoc. So that thing should be curtailed in the programming itself. The programming language, you never see any ambiguous grammar. Okay, so parse tree, it should be unique. Should be unique. Am I clear? But it is a tough. It is a parse tree can be two type, from left side on the right side. But forget about left right side. We always take the parsing tree from the left side, and that should be unique. If that is unique, then we call unambiguous grammar. Now I am making a statement. To find an unambiguous grammar from a context-free grammar, it is an undecidable problem. From regular language, it is great, it's simple. So if you have a regular language, and then you can have a regular grammar, and your parse tree will be one and only, and that is a linear problem. But if you have a different, I can generate different sets of grammar, and can generate the same sentences. It is context-free grammar. This is the problem starts. And this is the not only problem, this is a challenge. The context-free grammar for the same language, they have a 10 grammars. And for the 10 grammars, if maybe more than 10 grammars, okay. If 9 of them grammars give unambiguity, and if one grammar give unambiguous, then we tell that grammar is the unambiguous grammar, and that language is a unambiguous language. Am I talking sense? What I wish to say, that it is very, very problematic, in fact undecidable problem. It is what is the way to solve undecidable problem? By trial and error. So if we say a trial and error for N10 grammar, they are generating same sentences. It is very possible, which is not possible in regular grammar. So it is a possible, and it is you have to derive by hand or some automated programs whether it is unambiguous and ambiguous. So same grammar can be generated by unambiguous grammar and unambiguous grammar. Our main focus should be unambiguous grammar, and unambiguous grammar, to find unambiguous grammar is a ad hoc solution, and to it is a undecidable problem. What is undecidable problem? I have told in the beginning of the classes, that is the beauty of the automata, that they can teach you what are the solvables, unsolvable, solvable, which are polynomial, what is not polynomial, like this. Thank you. Okay. Thank you all. Okay. Look towards today 8 p.m.